I like to read in different translations because it kind of shakes it up in my mind and makes me stop and pause and think. So anyway, I'm going to introduce with a commentator's note for Colossians 3, and then we'll go into the scripture. Paul knows the people in Colossae are facing many religious and philosophical options, none of which are neutral. Notice that Paul doesn't say, just add Jesus to what you already believe, or factor Jesus into your philosophy, or include Jesus in this or that ritual. The claim that Jesus is Lord does not allow that. If Jesus is creator, sustainer, and redeemer of all creation, then all other teachings must give way. All people must bow before him and only him. Okay, Colossians chapter 3. So it comes down to this. Since you have been raised with the Anointed One, the liberating King, set your mind on heaven above. The Anointed is there, seated at God's right hand. Stay focused on what's above, not on earthly things. Because your old life is dead and gone, your new life is now hidden and meshed with the Anointed One who is in God. On that day, when the Anointed One, who is our very life, is revealed, you will be revealed with him in glory. So kill your earthly impulses, loose sex, impure actions, unbridled sensuality, wicked thoughts, and greed, which is essentially idolatry. It's because of these that God's wrath is coming upon the sons and daughters of disobedience, so avoid them at all costs. These are the same things you once pursued, and together you spawned a life of evil. But now, make sure you shed such things: anger, rage, spite, slander, and abusive language. And don't go on lying to each other, since you have sloughed away your old skin along with its evil practices, for a fresh new you, which is continually renewed in knowledge according to the image of the one who created you. In this recreation, there is no distinction between Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, by barbarian and conqueror, or slave and free, because the Anointed is the whole and dwells in us all. Since you were set apart by God, made holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with a holy way of life: compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Put up with one another. Forgive. Pardon any offenses against one another as the Lord has pardoned you. But you should act in kind, because you should act in kind. But above all things, put on love. Love is the perfect tie to bind these together. Let your hearts fall under the rule of the Anointed's peace, the peace that you were called to as one body, and be thankful. Let the word of the Anointed One richly inhabit your lives. With all wisdom, teach, counsel, and instruct one another. Sing the songs. Compose hymns and songs inspired by the Spirit. Keep on singing. Sing to God from hearts full and spilling over with thankfulness. Surely, no matter what you are doing, speaking, writing, or working, do it all in the name of Jesus our Master, sending thanks through him to God our Father. This is the word of the Lord. Let's pray. Father God in heaven, this morning we gather to worship you, to worship your name, to worship who you are, to set our focus and our minds on you, Lord. There are so many distractions that come into our lives throughout the week, throughout the course of just a given day, Lord. Our culture, family, relationships, Lord. Lord, I pray this morning that as we are gathered here, that we do set our affections on you, that we worship you wholly for who you are, Lord. Just thank you for this time that we can gather. In Jesus' name, amen. Mm-hmm.
I don't deserve your mercy. I never earned your love. You saw me break. You heard my cry. You reached down and touched my life. Your love is beyond measure. Your mercy has no end. And you take the dull and ruin things and make them shine, shine, shine. You walk from darkness into the light. Took our stains and made them. Thankful heart, I bring my offering and my sacrifices are not what you can give, but what I alone can give to you.
Good morning, everybody. Before you sit down, in addition to hugging and loving on each other, you need a communication card and you need a pen. There will be a test. Go say hey to everybody. Do you ever feel like Dick Van Dyke?
What's that?
From Mary Poppins? What's that?
I don't really think much of it, to be honest. Kind of just do it.
Thank you.
better get these. I don't know what's going on.
Yeah, I'm preloading. Well, if I look at Mrs. Rowe and she's crying, then I know I'm going to cry. So, and she's crying, so it's all good. But welcome again. Everybody hold up your communication card in your hand. If you don't have it, get it. You're going to need it. And your pen. I want to see him. Let's go. I'll wait. We can go long. Frank's roast is going to burn, not ours. Okay, good. So this is a good... We're going to do something different today. I didn't ask Jordan, but we're going long anyway. So, on that communication card, you don't have to put your name on the front, but on the back, this is what we're going to put on it. Pray for, put down the name of your unsaved friend that you want prayed for. Yes, surely you have friends. Most of them are saved. Second one. Put down the name of the person who is hurting that needs to be prayed for. It could be. Praying for him twice ain't bad. Number three. Pray for the family member or friend, put down the name of the family member or friend who is searching for Jesus. One, two, three. Number four, put down the name of a friend you praise God for. You can put your wife, Frank. Yep. Hey, if I'm crying, you're crying. Number five. Put down the name of the person you don't want to pray for, but who needs it. I'll leave these here for you, Jordan. And just because you're married doesn't mean you have to use the same card. You can each do one. Because I know you know other people than the ones Frank knows, Shirley. And you can fold that up, inside or out, or outside in, whichever one. When that communication, or when the offering back, make sure you put that in there. Great way to start it. So, good morning. It's an exciting day to worship God. Don't worry, that came to me at 12:30 last night when I got off of work after talking to someone about Jesus. And she's probably not watching right now, but her first question was, "So Bill, Amos 3:3, can you explain that to me?" And I'm like, "Oh, Amos 3:3, work with me, Vanessa." And for the next 2 hours after I got off of work, we were talking about God. So, what a great morning to be together. Great time of friends, fellowship and food yesterday at men's breakfast. Great time to just be together. Great time to see friends. Randy, good to see you and your family together. Thanks for dragging the grandkids out. We're happy to see them too. Probably them more, they're cuter than you. But we love you too. But welcome, if you're new, yeah, we don't go this deep that quick, but it was a great time to think about that last night and this morning. If you're new to us, in the trifold in front of you in the seat back, there are all the ministries that are going on here. Student ministries, immediately after service, we have the junior high and high school getting together. Midweek, we have Awana. Saturdays, we have Celebrate Recovery for those wanting to plug into that. On that same communication card, if you have any questions about any of those, please let us know. We'd be happy to get information to you. For guests, please let us know. Back, there's usually a gift for you for just saying thanks for coming. We'd love to say thanks for coming and answer any questions and say thanks for coming. Yeah. Let's see. Ladies paint night is coming up on the 17th. There's plenty of openings. So ladies, there's no biscuits and gravy. Sorry, but there is good fellowship. So this Friday, 6 p.m., 6:30, 6 p.m. Andrea, if you have any questions, is right there sitting next to her father-in-law, Randy. Hi, Randy. And see, sign-ups are out next to the information table by the door. This is an aside. You didn't know this, Jordan, but I just got notified of it. Chaplains Academy. You guys have heard about the chaplains that we have, and there's about four or five of us here. If you'd like to learn about the Chaplains Academy, please write on a communication card. We will have some, me and I think Ed's back there, and let's see, Misty's around. So those in the Academy would be happy, Jeff's here, to tell you about the amazing time learning more about how we can be servants of God as members of our church, just being an extension of his hands and feet. So if you have questions about that, it starts the 6th of April, and it's in the classes are in the evening for, how many was it, 3 or 6 weeks? I can't remember that long ago. But if you have any questions about it and you want to get plugged in, it's at Bayside Bridgeway. And great opportunity to grow in your understanding of what you are capable to do to help other people and serve here and in the church and outside the church. So get plugged into that. See us, chaplains, if you have any more information, if you need more information. The Easter Jam Family Fun Day is going to be April 8th, 1:30 to 3:30 p.m. here, outside, inside, all around the church. We are in need of plastic eggs and candy. Just across from the information table is a white boxy thingy to put plastic eggs and individually wrapped candy for the kids to do to search for eggs out in the back. So we need candy, we need eggs, we need y'all to come on out and have a good time. At the information table is some areas, places to volunteer. So you do have talent, I promise you. The Bible says so. So sign up and come out and have a good time. It's a great outreach in the community and just time of fellowship together with one another. So, Vacation Bible School's Keepers of the Kingdom, the Armor of God, July 10th through the 13th. That'll be in the evening. We don't have a time for yet. I didn't see the time. At the usual time. So if you have questions, Pastor Jordan, his cell phone number is... Call the office. It's in the evenings, and we got time to plan, but great opportunity. You are not getting up here and preaching. It's a time where you get a chance to be a part of helping a young person learn more about God, and tertiarily, you get to learn more about him too. So it's kind of fun. So please come out and join the activity July 10th through the 13th. Signups are also at the information table. Life groups are continuing to go on as well. The table at the back, Jeff and Lorraine will be back there to answer any questions you have about that. And if there's not a group that works in your time frame, let them know. We'll work on getting another opportunity to open up another group. That is all we have for announcements. If you have any questions about any of these things, please let us know. Please put it on your communication card. Don't leave having questions. Make sure those prayer cards get in that offering basket. And let's pray for our offering. If you have any questions, we'll have leaders available afterward to answer questions. Heavenly Father, thank you for the time to worship you. Thank you for your word. Thank you for our opportunity to gather peacefully in an amazing country where we can do so openly. Thank you for loving us and sending your son to die for us. Thank you for allowing us to know you. Lord, the activities we're honored and blessed to participate in here on Sunday, throughout the week, throughout the year, Lord, is an extension of what we do in your name. We pray for this offering that we give to you joyfully for the continued expansion of your kingdom, your continued work through through us as your servants, the missionaries around the world that we sponsor and support, for the children in the village that we support. Lord, we lift them all up to you, knowing that this offering will be used, and we look forward to its fruit and understanding it in the kingdom hereafter. We pray for this offering and dedicate it to you in Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen.
Thank you.
sound, joy of having you, a wonderful sound, and love of heaven now, a beautiful sound, the joy.
Amen. Oh, it's a good day. Jesus is alive. We're here together. That's wonderful. How are we doing? Wonderful. Wonderful. Hey, can we thank the worship team? And you guys, your beautiful voices. I love acoustic weeks. We get to hear more than normally everyone's voices, and I love it. It's a wonderful thing when God's people are gathered in one place singing his praises. Voices ring out. God makes our voices sound more angelic than they could on their own. Oh, no. I don't know what happened. I just heard a noise. Nina, is your stuff okay? Something fell over here. I don't know what, but I just heard a noise. Your sax and flute are upright, so that's always a good thing. I don't know. Hey, if we haven't met before, my name is Jordan. I am the lead pastor here. We got all kinds of stuff going on. We are just about to enter into the Easter season. Next week, we've been working on writing these devotions, and we're going to have this 40-day devotional available next Sunday. At least it should be. I need to send it to the printer. But it will be available next Sunday, and it's going to be 40 days of devotion. We're going to be beginning that Easter series next Sunday, but the devotions won't begin until the following Wednesday, which is Ash Wednesday. That is February 22nd. Part of this, during these 40 days, generally it is good practice to fast from something. And so I've been asking each week for you to be praying about what you are going to be fasting from, what God is going to lead you to do. If you are considering doing a food fast, that is definitely something you should consult with your doctor, medical professional. Make sure you're able to do that in a way that is going to be safe. But it does not have to be food. You can fast from some other form of something. You can fast from social media. You can fast from driving Fords or something. Sorry about that. No, it needs to be something that you would do in your normal everyday life. So if you don't drive a Ford normally, fasting from driving Fords, that would not be a good thing. we were having a little conversation yesterday, and a little phrase came to mind. It was definitely from the Holy Spirit, because I'm not as this witty, but it was this phrase came to mind: if it does not change your life, it's not going to change your life. If it does not cause a shift in your daily life, it's not a proper fast. Because what we're supposed to do, and food fast kind of encapsulates this, we are taking something, removing something that we depend on, and replacing that time paying attention to God. As Jesus said, he was quoting from Deuteronomy when Satan was tempting him, Jesus said, man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. We are recognizing that our dependence is not on these things that we are given up. Our dependence is on God. So it should cause a change, a shift in our lives during these 40 days, in which during those times we are focusing our attention on God and what he has for us. And so as we have these devotions, as we're going through every day, reading through these things, every week talking in our small groups, talking with our brothers and sisters in Christ about what's going on, God is going to speak. He's going to move in big ways. So I am excited for this time, and I can't wait to begin. But we got other things we got to get to this morning. This morning we are in the seventh and final part of our first series. We've been looking each week at different firsts in the Bible. We began all the way with the first day of creation. Then we looked at offering God first fruits. Then we looked at the first human king over Israel, and then the first temple in Israel. Then we jumped into the New Testament. We looked at Jesus calling his first disciples. Then last week we looked at him performing his first miracle. And if you've noticed, we have run almost the entire way through the Bible. The grand narrative of the Bible has been contained in this series, and so we are going to round things off and end things with actually multiple firsts, as they are told in the last book of the Bible in Revelation. We're going to be beginning with the first seal in Revelation 6, but we're going to be jumping around. I tend to take a really long time to get through small portions of the Bible, and yet we have gone through the entire Bible in 7 weeks. We're going to be going through the entirety of Revelation this morning. Kickoff's not till 3:30, so we got time. No. We're going to get through this stuff. It's going to be good. Before we actually dive into God's Word, we got to talk about Jesus. Jesus is going to return. If you didn't know that, that is a reality. This is not a question of if, this is a question of when. Jesus is going to return. It's been a long time, 2,000 years, or almost 2,000 years. It's easy, because it's been a long time, to go, well, that's not going to happen. He was lying about that. Or, you know, it's been such a long time, we might as well live our lives as though everything is going to stay the same, because who knows how much longer it's going to happen. That is not a good attitude to have. We have to understand Jesus is coming back. And during this time, as we wait for him to return, he does not mean for us to get lulled into a false sense of security and feeling like everything's okay as it is. What he wants for us during this time is to actually turn to him, live our lives for him, and prepare ourselves for his return. Jesus is coming back, and we need to be ready. Amen? Amen. Let's pray, and then we'll jump into God's Word together. Father God in heaven, your name is holy. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. God, we desire to see your kingdom. As John saw the fullness of your kingdom, we want to see that fullness become a reality. We want to see, God, your will being done here on earth just as it is done in heaven. We ask, Father, that you give us every single day exactly what we need, our daily bread, so that we can live our lives completely devoted to you. We ask, Lord, that you help us with our forgiveness. Because just as you have forgiven us for sinning against you, you have called us to forgiveness, to forgive others when they have sinned against us. And Lord, help us to not fall to temptation, but deliver us from the evil one, because yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. And it is because of you, Jesus, that we pray. Amen. Revelation chapter 6, verses 1 and 2 say, I watched as the Lamb opened the first of the seven seals, and then I heard one of the four living creatures say in a voice like thunder, Come. I looked, and there before me was a white horse. Its rider held a bow, and he was given a crown, and he rode out as a conqueror bent on conquest. So we've got another one final little time jump that we have here. We left off in Cana in Galilee, where Jesus performed his first miracle at the very beginning of his ministry. Since that time, Jesus called his disciples to him more formally. He went around from town to town preaching about the good news about God's kingdom. He performed many miracles to prove, to show other people that he was the Messiah, he was the one that God promised who would come, the root of David, the descendant, the seed of David who would come and sit on the throne of Israel, the promised one who would crush the head of the serpent. Jesus was the one who was the fulfillment, the embodiment of the presence of God among his people. Jesus fulfilled all of these things that we have looked at throughout this series. And as he went from town to town, the Jewish leaders in Israel, they got a little upset with him. They felt very threatened by him, and so they conspired with one of his disciples to kill him. And eventually their plot succeeded, and he was hung on a cross, and he died for all of us. But death could not keep him, and the grave could not hold him. And on the third day, he rose again. He rose to life, and he showed that we can have new life in him. After that time, he spent a period of time, not exactly sure how many days, but he spent some days with his disciples, and he was teaching them further things. And he told them during that time, after he had risen, before he ascended to heaven, he told them, when I am gone, I'm going to be leaving you. When I am gone, I'm going to send you my Spirit. And my Spirit is going to lead you in all truth. He's going to remind you of all the things I have told you, and you are going to be empowered by my Spirit. I am leaving you physically, but I will return soon. So Jesus ascended to heaven about 7 weeks after Easter Resurrection Sunday. The Jewish people were celebrating the Feast of Pentecost, and during that time, all of the disciples went out into Jerusalem, and the Holy Spirit descended on them and filled them and empowered them to go and speak about the good news about God's kingdom, to tell people that Jesus is the Messiah, that God's kingdom has drawn near, and that Jesus paid with his blood the price for entry, for us to enter into God's kingdom, that because Jesus died, we are able to enter God's kingdom and live life anew. They spread this news far and wide. Eventually, even Gentiles, those who are not genealogically Jewish, even they were accepted into this community. Even they were allowed to enter into God's kingdom. And these people began being called Christians, ones who followed Christ, the Messiah. And they went around and they spread the good news about God's kingdom, and they waited for Jesus to return because he said he was coming back soon. And they figured out how it is that they could live in community together, because sometimes when you're living in community together, you butt heads with people and you got to have some conflict mediation and things like that. They learned how to get along, and they waited for Jesus to return. And they learn from people like Paul and Peter and the other disciples how to worship God and how to live for God more. And they waited for Jesus to return. And they celebrated communion together. And they met in their homes. And they broke bread. And they shared time together. And they waited for Jesus to return. And they waited and they waited and they waited because he said he was coming back soon. But then he wasn't there. And as Jesus' 12 disciples were martyred, one and one, one by one, they were killed. Until there was only John left. People were going, is Jesus actually coming back? How is this okay? Why, if Jesus has brought God's kingdom near, if we have entered into God's kingdom, why is his peace, God's peace, not covering the entire world? Why is there still evil things happening? Where is Jesus? How long is this going to be? Maybe this is all there is. Revelation. This is Jesus appeared to John in a vision, and he revealed some things to him. That's revelation, revealed. These things were revealed to John as an answer to those questions. Why hasn't Jesus returned yet? Why is there still evil in the world? How long is it going to be? And so this vision is revealed to John in chapters 4 and 5. John sees the very throne room of God with living creatures and angels and elders all bowing down and worshiping God. This is his throne room. In all of his glory, he sees God. And it's this beautiful sight. And then there is this scroll that John sees. And it has writing on both sides of it, but it's rolled up and it's sealed with seven seals. And the angels are calling out, who is worthy to open up the seals on this scroll? And it says there was no one in heaven or on earth who was worthy, who was able to open the seals on the scroll. And John weeps because he knows the significance. He knows that in this scroll are the answers that we're all looking for. He knows that in this scroll is written the answers of why hasn't Jesus returned? Why is there evil in the world? He understands the significance this scroll holds, and so he weeps because it's not able to be opened. The answer isn't able to be revealed. And then one of the elders turns to him and he says, hey, it's okay. Don't cry. Look over there. It's the lion from the tribe of Judah, the root of David. He is worthy. He is able to open the seals on the scroll. And John gets excited and he looks over there, and instead of seeing a lion as was described to him, he sees a lamb that looks like it had been slain. And this lamb that was slain, this lion from Judah, the root of David, this offspring who was going to reverse the curse, this Jesus begins opening the seals on the scroll one by one. And so we see here in chapter 6, the first two verses, we see the first seal being broken. And as a result of that seal being broken, a rider appears. Someone riding a white horse. And he has a bow in his hand and a crown is placed on his head. And he goes out as a conqueror to go and conquer. Revelation, primarily what a lot of people end up doing, they try to read Revelation and look out at the world events around them and go, how does this correspond with what I'm reading in the Bible? And it's easy to look out in our world, even to look out in history, and find someone who fits the description of a conqueror going out to conquer. There's lots of them. There have been lots of conquerors going out to conquer in the world. There's going to continue to be conquerors going out in the world to conquer. The purpose of Revelation is not to make us look outward into the world and see how exterior events relate to what we're reading in Revelation. The purpose of Revelation is for us to look inward at ourselves as we look upward and wait for our Savior. If you're reading Revelation and you are only looking outward at the world around you, you are missing what the Spirit is saying to the churches. You're missing out on so much. The purpose of Revelation is to make us look inward. We see over the course of the next seals, as they are being opened, war, famine, disease, death. The fifth seal shows all the people who had been killed crying out to God, how much longer? How long is it going to be, Lord? In the sixth seal, we see natural disasters, earthquakes and fires and such. And we go, that's the answer? This scroll is opened up, and the answer that we have to why hasn't Jesus returned, why is there evil in the world, we see that the answer is there are people going out to conquer, there are wars in the world, that there is famine and disease and pestilence, that there are natural disasters, that there are people who should not have been murdered who were. That's the answer? Yes, it is. Why should that bring us comfort? Why should that be the answer to why Jesus has not returned yet and why there is evil in the world? Because we see as this scroll is opened one by one and unfurled, we see that it was all written down already. All of the conquerors throughout history, all of the wars that have happened, all of the famines, all of the disease, all of the natural disasters, all of the terrible things were already written down. We see that even as evil exists in the world, God is not out of control. God is not surprised by what is happening. In fact, it was all written already, which means the ending has already been written. We can be certain, as this scroll opens up, we can be certain that God remains on the throne, that God remains in control. When the seventh seal is opened, part of that involves seven angels being given trumpets, and they sound them one by one. And so we have a second first thing to look at in Revelation. If we turn to chapter 8, starting in verse 6, it says, "And then the seven angels who had the seven trumpets prepared to sound them. The first angel sounded his trumpet, and there came hail and fire mixed with blood, and it was hurled down upon the earth. A third of the earth was burned up, a third of the trees were burned up, and all the green grass was burned up." There's a constant theme throughout as each of the trumpets are sounded, and that theme is the fraction one-third. One-third of the trees, one-third of the seas, one-third of the rivers, one-third of the land, one-third. Every single time it's one-third. There's only one trumpet, the fifth trumpet that is sounded, that does not have a third, and that's when locusts come out from the abyss and they are told to go out into the earth and torment anyone who has not been sealed by God on their forehead. And even in that one, even though it doesn't say one-third specifically, it still shows a partial judgment. These trumpets that sound God's judgment are all partial. They're all fractions. Even one-third is not even a majority. It is only a little bit. And that shows us throughout these judgments, throughout these trumpets as they are sounded, that God's judgment, even currently and in the future or wherever these events take place, that judgment is only partial at the moment. It's only a little bit. Why has Jesus not returned? Why is evil in the world? Because God is only showing a little bit of his judgment right now, because there is still time. There are still others that we are waiting on. There are still those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life who need to come and join us in our waiting for Jesus to return. There are still evils that those who are doomed to destruction are still gathering up and building up for themselves. They still need to continue in their evil acts. All of this stuff is still mounting because the judgment is only partial at the moment. It's not going to be forever, but right now it is. Jesus hasn't returned. Evil exists because it's only in part right now. The sad thing is that there are those who see even God's partial judgment, and they don't take that as an opportunity to turn to him. Instead, they look at his partial judgment and they go, "Huh, yeah, see, he's not going to do anything to me. I can keep doing what I want." And John says in chapter 9, verse 20, he says, "The rest of mankind, after all these trumpets have blown," he says, "the rest of mankind that were not killed by these plagues still did not repent of the work of their hands. They did not stop worshiping demons and idols of gold and silver and bronze and stone and wood, idols that cannot see or hear or walk. Nor did they repent of their murders, their magic arts, their sexual immorality, or their thefts. They look at even just the partial judgment of God, and they still turn away from him. God's judgment at the moment is partial, but it won't be forever. With the sounding of the seventh trumpet, Jesus' inauguration, his sitting on the throne as king in his glory, is announced with that seventh trumpet. And then the waiting ends. Seven angels are given seven bowls which contain God's wrath, and they are told to pour God's wrath out on the earth. And so we have our third and final first thing in Revelation in chapter 16, verses 1 and 2. John says, "Then I heard a loud voice from the temple saying to the seven angels, 'Go pour out the seven bowls of God's wrath on the earth.' The first angel went and poured out his bowl on the land, and ugly and painful sores broke out on the people who had the mark of the beast and worshipped his image." What we see as these bowls are poured out is not a partial judgment. It is completely wiping them out. On the land, on the sea, on the rivers, in the air, everywhere, everything, destruction. God's judgment is in part now, but it will not be forever. Why has Jesus not returned? Why is there evil in the world? Because when God pours out his wrath on the earth, it's going to be fast. It's going to be final. When the seventh bowl is poured out, a voice calls out from the throne, very similar to what Jesus said when he was on the cross. The voice calls out, "It is done." When God's wrath, we sit here and we go, "God, we want you to bring judgment. We want you to make things right. We want you to get rid of evil. We want all this stuff to be gone." When that happens, it's going to be fast and there is no going back. Woe to anyone who has not been sealed by God's Spirit at that point in time. We should not wish that on anyone. Instead, we should take this as an opportunity to go, there's still time. There's still time. Right now, God's judgment is only in part. When it happens fully and completely, when that wrath is poured out, there is no going back. Why hasn't Jesus returned yet? Why is there evil in the world? Because we are not ready. We are not ready for it to happen yet. Jesus said he's going to return like a thief coming in the night. It's going to be completely unexpected, and it's going to be very sudden. The time that we have right now is not meant to be to look at the partial judgment and go, "Oh, that's all God can do? Okay, I'm going to go do my own thing." The purpose of this is to look inwardly and say, "Where is my rebellion? Where is my sin? Where's my heart? What idols have I been holding on to?" As I look at the partial judgment of God in the world today, what idols have I been clinging to? What idols have I set up in my life that I am worshiping them? I am spending more time with them. I am investing in my relationship with them more than I am investing in my relationship with the King of the universe. Whose judgment am I more afraid of than God's? Whose wrath am I more concerned about than God's? Am I going around and looking at this world as though everything's just going to continue living, being as it is for all of eternity? I might as well not even make an attempt, not even try to live my life differently because it's just going to keep going onward. Is that how we are responding? Or are we looking at our God and saying, "No, I need to make a change in my life"? The response that we need to make as a result of reading this passage, of reading this book, is to look inwardly. Say, "God, where do you want to work on me next?" And to follow him where he leads. God's judgment is in part. He's waiting. There is There is time at the moment, but it's not going to be forever. It's not going to be forever. Jesus is going to return. For those of us who know him, oh, it's going to be amazing. But for those who don't, it's not going to be that amazing. It's time to turn to Jesus, if we have not already. And if we have turned to him, it's time to turn to him again and again and again. Because he's coming back and he's given us time to prepare for his return. Let's use that time well. Amen? Amen. As the band comes up, I want to finish out this morning by reading the final bit of Revelation. Chapter 22, starting verse 12. I'll read through to the end and then we'll pray and sing one more song. Jesus says, "Behold, I am coming soon. My reward is with me, and I will give to everyone according to what he has done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed are those who wash their robes, that they may have the right to the tree of life and may go through the gates into the city. Outside are the dogs, those who practice magic arts and sexually immoral, the murderers, the idolaters, and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. I, Jesus, have sent my angel to give you this testimony for the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David and the bright morning star. The Spirit and the bride say, 'Come.' And let him who hears say, 'Come.' Whoever is thirsty, let him come, and whoever wishes, let him take the free gift of the water of life. I warn everyone who hears the words of this of the prophecy of this book. If anyone adds anything to them, God will add to him the plagues described in this book. And if anyone takes words away from this book of prophecy, God will take away from him his share in the tree of life and in the holy city, which are described in this book. He who testifies to these things says, 'Yes, I am coming soon.'" Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with God's people. Amen. Jesus, we praise you, our mighty deliverer, the true conqueror who has won the battle, who has written the ending, who has said, "It is finished." Jesus, we thank you for this life you have given us, for the love you have shown us, for the grace you have poured out on us, for the time that we can prepare for your return. We love you, Lord. We thank you and we praise you. And Jesus, it's because of you that we pray. Amen. Night.
God bless. Have a great week.